Good.
Yes.
All right, lights, camera, action on this. So again, welcome to back to recitation on this. I assume everyone's caught up on breath at this point. The in part of what we're going to be talking about in today's recitation is, for the most part, the mechanics of, if you will, the beginnings of assignment three on this. Certainly, if we finish up a little bit early, I'd be happy to take questions about the current assignment on this. But before we get into the mechanics of the assignment, a little bit about, if you will, what the memory manager is as specific to OS 161, what you currently have right now, the dumb VM, and kind of use that as an example of how it works and why it is not going to work very well vis-a-vis what you need to implement for assignment number three on this. So again, when we're talking about interfaces here, we're just talking about the current functions that dumb VM has in place. If you haven't done so already, you're probably going to want to take a look through those. Don't spend a whole lot of time trying to study out dumb VM. Just give kind of a bird's eye overview on this, because it is not how you want to set up and design your good virtual memory manager. Again, it's an example of how not to do things. Sometimes by design it's made that way. Sometimes it's just because the designers at Harvard were looking to throw together something quick and dirty to support your assignment number two on this. So again, that's what we're talking about in terms of these virtual memory interfaces in dumb VM. And let's talk about in terms of what you need to do in terms of designing a good virtual memory manager on this. So let's see here. Assignment three is divided up into three parts on this, and I indicated before we skipped out of lecture on this. For better or for worse, the first one is going to be due the week after the midterm. So again, this is this week, next week in on the white sands of Tahiti. The week after that is the midterm, and then the week after that is essentially assignment 3.1 is due. So that's, if you're coming up fairly soon on that, if you are taking off the week of spring break, again, that doesn't leave a whole lot of time for this assignment. It's a fairly short one as OS 161 goes, but again, take that for what it will. Assignment 2.2 is big, assignment 3.2 is unfortunately even bigger, so forewarning about that. But assignment 3.1, I will also say, is orthogonal to assignment 2.2, which means if you don't have assignment 2.2 completely done, you actually don't need it for assignment 3.1. You can get started and complete this portion of the assignment even if your assignment 2 syscall stuff is still not fully functional. You will need the assignment 2.2 stuff for, if you will, the page tables assignment. So that's going to be a double whammy if you don't have assignment 2 functioning by that point in time. And then the last part is swapping. That's right at the end of the semester. That's a cool assignment, and we'll get to that in just a little bit. So in terms of the virtual memory subsystem, I should say too that we use the term virtual memory and address spaces somewhat interchangeably. They're not quite the same thing. Virtual memory system is, if you will, the compendium of the thingamabob that manages memory in OS 161, or for that matter, any operating system. A subset of that is the concept of the address space and the address space structure, which we just got through kind of introducing and lecture on that. So if you will, the data structure of, let's see, the address space is part of your virtual memory system on that. So what is actually, or are some of the goals, what's going on here? Again, a memory system is something we're, again, trying to map virtual addresses into physical addresses in memory. And again, ideally, what we want is it to go through, if the user references a virtual address, it goes to the TLB cache, and it's translated by hardware, and we don't even have to deal with any of this. But again, occasionally there's going to be a page fault, and we're going to have to go to the operating system, where we do have to use our data structures to repopulate the TLB cache with updated information here. Now, a couple other things. Goals of the virtual memory system. Remember, is we want the user to see an address space that is, remember we were talking about uniform, contiguous, okay, something always mine, all mine. I get what appears to be an entire, if you will, 4 gigabyte address space all to myself, and my segments are kind of always uniform and apparently in the same location. That's what we're talking about, if you will, contiguous and kind of also predictable to that. The MMU, again, that's a synonym, if you will. The TLB is part of the memory management hardware on this. And again, we talked about this before, so just go through this very quickly on this here. If you will, the user programs should not have to deal with managing this. This is something that is actually managed for them by the kernel, with a few exceptions. Like, the user does have to specify to the kernel, for example, how to grow the heap. That's the whole point of, if you will, heap, is it is a user-managed segment of memory. But aside from that, essentially, the virtual memory management is done by the kernel itself here. The purpose of this two virtual memory, this is the concept of process isolation. It provides stability and security to the user so that one user process does not munge on or corrupt another user process. It can bomb its own address space, but it can't bomb other users' address spaces. And if it bombs, it doesn't take down the entire system, and you avoid lots of blue screens on this. And other things, for example, we can implement things like swapping to allow, let's say, a 4 gigabyte system to actually use 8 gigabytes worth of memory by swapping stuff out to the hard drive on this. So that's kind of the general overview. We've been talking about this a lot in lecture, and let's actually kind of dig into some of the nitty-gritties on this here. So in terms of interfaces here, oh, I should probably bring up an example of code here. But these are, if you will, the functions that are already given to you in VM.h. They're also already implemented in a hacky version in, if you will, dumb VM. So again, if you look at arcmips VM, dumbvm.c, you'll see implementations of these functions or some of these functions already in dumb VM. Kind of to go through them here. VM Bootstrap is what appears to be what you call when you initially boot up the system, okay? It's your chance to, if you will, initialize your data structures and get started with that. This is actually going to be somewhat problematic for reasons we'll get to in a few minutes on this. So it is not what it seems to be. So if you're taking notes, just kind of maybe put an asterisk by this. VM Bootstrap is problematic. It's not exactly a bootstrap. Alloc K pages and free K pages, this is essentially functions that are going to be called by kmalloc and kfree. So if you want to know, like, how does the kernel actually get memory? Well, let's say, in other words, if I call kmalloc and I say, hey, give me 10 bytes worth of memory, and malloc returns and says, here's a pointer to 10 bytes of memory. How does it work underneath the hood is kmalloc calls down and asks for occasionally blobs of memory from your memory manager in 4K chunks. So in other words, kmalloc will call this underlying routine alloc k pages or free k pages for kfree. And that actually is what kmalloc uses to portion off memory on this. And these are the two functions that you're actually going to be needing to write in part for assignment 3.1. This is part of what is implemented improperly by dumb VM. So again, VM Bootstrap, it doesn't work very well right now. Alloc K pages and free K pages, those are the routines that are used by kmalloc and kfree to actually get and release, if you will, chunks of memory that are in turn parceled out to the caller on this. Questions on the first three so far? Okay, TLB shootdown, to be honest for now, kind of forget it until you get to swapping. It's essentially what you need to do is, there was a couple of questions in lecture about maybe occasionally needing to flush out entries in the TLB. That's what this does. And unless and until you get to swapping, that's something that you can kind of glide by right now. VM fault is really important though. That is the routine that gets called every time there is, drumroll, a page fault. So you're going to need to know about this early on, and you're going to need to do a lot of implementation and optimization in this. So again, remember, if a user refers to a virtual address, the TLB checks to see if there's entry. If not, it does a page fault, which means this routine immediately gets called and says, memory manager, there was a page fault. What do you want to do? And you, in turn, need to tell it what to do. That's kind of the essence of, if you will, assignment 3.2 and, to a lesser extent, a little bit, assignment 3.3 on this. Next part about VM interfaces. This I'm going to skip over somewhat because this is more applicable to assignment 3.2. But again, we have these functions in terms of address space. And again, this is, if you will, the data structure that is used by, if you will, a user process to represent how its, if you will, address space appears in user land on this. And you can see it's basically functions to set up the address space, destroy it, copy it. You can kind of imagine that's what's called a fork. Activate and deactivate Kind of nifty what these two functions do. Essentially, what they do is they populate the TLB or set up the TLB to be populated to use a particular address space. Because, think about it. Remember we were talking about in lecture and I said, like, every user gets to assume that, let's say, address 400,000 is the beginning of, if you will, the code segment. Well, that's great. We have different address spaces to keep track of which user we're talking about. But what about the TLB? Because you think about it, let's say process A runs and it's using its executable and virtual address 400,000, which points to, let's say, physical address 1 million. And those entries, those translation entries, are currently in the TLB. But then there's a context switch. And the second process, B, starts running on this. Well, wait a minute, there's still, if you will, entries in the TLB that, if you will, say that virtual address 400,000 maps to address 1 million, physical address 1 million. Well, that's true for process A, but it's not true for process B. So in other words, we need to update the TLB and the caches. That's actually what this activate and deactivate stuff does, so that we can now point virtual address 400,000 over to whatever physical address of, if you will, process B is. So that's kind of what those two do. You don't have to grasp all this right now. Just, again, what's going to be most important for assignment 3.1 is, if you will, a lot of the stuff on this page and some of the stuff that we're going to be talking about later on. The VM enter pages, okay, functions on this function and this slide, that's actually what you're going to be implementing for assignment 3.2, which is going to be lengthier, but again, it's a little bit further down the pipe on this. So other things here, you can see this is basically defining, if you will, segments in memory. And again, remember, this is setting up. Remember, there was the one question at the end of the lecture, well, what about the various segments like stack, if you will, heap, if you will, the global segments. That's what these particular functions do. And again, that's part of assignment 3.2. Oh, by the way, you can see how it ties in here with loadelf, because remember, loadelf, that's actually what you were using in terms of like setting up and running the init process. Well, one of the things that loadelf does is it interfaces with your memory manager to set up, if you will, the memory segments to load stuff in from disk into particular areas of memory. All right, and last one again, you can kind of punt this to later on, but the S-break syscall, that is essentially what the user space uses to manipulate the heap. So essentially, this is what malloc calls down to. So in the same way that kmalloc calls down to kget pages, well, the user space level malloc program, if you ever looked at the internals of it, it calls down to a syscall, either S-break or a modern operating system, sometimes mmap. But that's kind of what's going on this. So, not spend a lot of time on that right now. All right, dumb VM here. Again, do look through this. Do know the overall design of dumb VM, so you can kind of, it does give you an idea about how to implement a memory manager on this. But again, it's not a good design, and it certainly will not pass the test for, if you will, assignment 3. So let's actually use this as a jumping off point to see how we can implement a proper virtual memory manager and what is it that Jeff is actually going to be looking for in terms of working code here. So let's see here. Dumb VM. All right. This, by the way, is physical memory. And the way it gets set up when OS 161 loads into, if you will, memory, when a system first boots up, when you launch OS 161 or when you boot your laptop or a real machine and Linux loads or whatever else it is, typically what happens is physical memory begins at zero and goes to whatever last p-adder. Remember, last p-adder, this is the last physical address, that's the amount of memory you actually have. Last hour we were talking about virtual addresses. On a virtual system, by definition, on a 32-bit system, by definition, you always have 2 to the 32-bit virtual addresses. How much physical memory, that depends upon essentially how many RAM chips you have in your system, which means it could be 4 gigabytes, it could be less than 4 gigabytes on that. So it could be 512 megabytes, 256. So this is actually going to move. We don't know about that. That's actually going to be a bit of a problem we'll see in about 10 minutes. The kernel always loads itself in at low mem. In other words, beginning at zero and loading on up. Now that is, the kernel loads in at address zero in physical memory. That's not how you refer to it in virtual memory on this. You probably have noticed in your error codes and whatnot, it'll say like TLB miss onload or kernel panic or what have you. It'll say, have you noticed a lot of on address, and you'll see a lot of 80 million, something like that. You'll see a lot of 80, yada, yada, yada on that. That's because, remember, there's different addressing modes with the MIPS chip. And I talked about this last week. I said one of them is what's called kernel direct map addressing on this. And that is essentially when you're in kernel mode, all addresses, you can refer to it by simply adding 80 million to it. So if the kernel is located in physical address 0 and on up, that means it appears in virtual address 80 million and up, which is why you're occasionally seeing errors and having to refer to addresses, especially if you're dealing with XFB right now. You're probably fond of this. There's lots of addresses beginning with 80 million on up. Well, it's referring to addresses in the kernel, because that's actually where it actually begins. All right, now, a couple things about this. How does WM actually work here? We have alloc K pages and free K pages, and let's see, I wonder if I can actually,
go on the full screen, go to the top right.
Where are we?
Go back to Firefox.
Firefox.
The highlighted blue.
No arrow in the top right.
Okay, but then it did.
You just click it.
And I did. Ooh, thank you, wizard. Okay. I think a picture is worth a thousand words. So now, there we go. Sorry about that, but I did want to, I think it's worth it here. Okay, we were talking earlier about what are some of these functions here. And in terms of alloc K pages and free K pages, these are the two routines that essentially get called down by, if you will, K malloc and K free when they need blocks of memory. And again, K malloc and K free request and release blocks of memory in terms of 4K chunks here. So let's actually take a look at what WM does. Right now, in terms of alloc K pages, it calls down to this getPPages routine, which we can take a look in just a second. It goes up there, and it calls this routine called RAMSTEALMEM. So essentially what RAMSTEALMEM does is it does just that. It steals memory. Remember back to the slide earlier where we had the kernel in the low part of memory, and then we had this huge chunk of, if you will, memory above the kernel on this. So what RAMSTEALMEM is, come on, there it is. Okay, RAMSTEALMEM if I say, give me, let's say, 10 pages of physical memory, what it does is it takes this first pediatric and just pushes it up by 10 pages. So I just keep stealing memory, and this first pediatric gets closer and closer and closer until it eventually hits last pediatric, and eventually my kernel crashes because it's out of memory. That is how, if you will, dumbVM gets you memory on this. So it simply starts at first pr and just goes all the way to the end of things. So let's back to this here. So in terms of what else we have here, free K pages, take a look at what that does. Nothing. Okay, which is why dumbVM leaks memory on this. So what you're going to need to do essentially for assignment 3.1 is implement working functions of these two things, allocate pages and free K pages. Certainly so that free K pages actually freeze memory, but that instead of calling this janky RAM steal mem thing, okay, what you want is allocate pages to either itself or better yet, call a working get P pages routine that checks your core map for the status of free pages and returns appropriately on this. So again, you can use this for a template for what you're going to need to do, but these are the functions you're going to need to know for, if you will, assignment 3.1. So if you will, free K pages, allocate pages, and the one right up above there, the get paid pages on this so far. Back to slides on this. And okay, physical memory management here. Okay. If what's going on in dumbVM here is it doesn't free allocated pages, you just saw it, it does nothing here. Okay, so it just keeps stealing RAM until, remember, it goes all the way over to the other side and boom, it hits end of memory and eventually it crashes the system. So what you need to do is, instead of just moving things up, you're going to have a data structure, we call it the core map, that tracks information on physical pages. Remember, your page table tracks information on virtual pages. The core map tracks information on physical pages. And part of the information it needs to track is the ability to reclaim or recycle pages on this. So you can kind of already see where this is going. There's going to be, let's say, an entry corresponding to a physical page. It'll say, is it in use or not? If it's not in use, we can say, here you go. Here's a piece of physical page. And when it's done, we're going to have to actually mark it as now being in free instead of just continually leaking memory on this. All right, dumbVM in terms of user address space. In other words, what's the problem and what we need to do. Let's take a look at how dumbVM actually works here. And again, you can look at the details of the code itself. But essentially, dumbVM follows, you remember we talked about this last Friday, Jeff was kind of proposing several potential memory models on this, and one of which is simply allocate to the user one big basin bounds segment of memory. And that didn't exactly work. And then we said, let's try the segment model, where in effect what we have is multiple segments. It's better than one big Uber segment, because it will, if you will, allow, you don't have to map the stuff in between the virtual segments here. But there's still a problem with that, and that is within the segments themselves, remember we came to the conclusion there's a problem because the virtual memory addresses in each of these segments have to map to, if you will, contiguous areas of physical memory. Does that ring a bell? Remember last Friday? Again, anyway, it was discussed on this. That's actually the implementation of dumbVM. dumbVM implements the slightly janky version of the segmentation approach to virtual memory on this. So we do have multiple segments, but within that, you can see this is actually the data structure for dumbVM here. You can see virtual address base 1, physical address base 1, and the number of pages, so base and bound. Same thing for segment number 2, base and bound here on this. So that's actually the implementation. This is real working code. This is what you're using right now, is the base and bounds approach to, if you will, memory segmentation on this. So problems with that is right now we have a fixed number of segments here. So you can see there it is. There's segment 1, there's segment 2, and there's a stack here. That's actually your working code. We have no support for more than 3 segments on this. And not just that here, is if 2 of the segments are used for text and data, essentially we have no room for a heap at all. As a matter of fact, if you look at your test code for assignment number 2, you will see in no place is malloc called. because, frankly, malloc would bomb out right now. Because really, there is, it's hard-coded, there's exactly three segments. There you go, segment one, segment two, and a stack on that. All right. So what you need to do is we're going to have to change things up a little bit. This is what we need to do. A real operating system has this, and what you're going to be implementing for assignment number three here is a variable number of segments. I can tell you right now in practice, you're probably, make it five or six, you'll be safe. Okay. You don't have to increase it much, but you definitely need to support it, at the very least, a heap on here. But the big thing here is we also need variable sized segments. The stack and the heap need to be variably sized. That was the question right at the end of lecture on that, in terms of what about inserts on this. Remember, some segments, like specifically the text segment, that's your executable code, they're stacked, they're allocated when a program launches. But there's other segments, specifically the stack and the heap, that do change dynamically, and so your memory manager is actually going to need to support that. So in other words, the stack segment and this heap segment, they actually need to change as your program is actually running. So this is change number one. Make sense? Questions? So again, to recap, WVM implements the segmentation approach to memory, and while it's better than a one big segment, it's still not good enough. What we need to do is, if you will, free up the number of segments and free up the size of the segments to float dynamically as the program executes. Problem number two, address translation on this. All right. Again, we said that dumbVM uses the, if you will, the segmentation approach to memory, which essentially uses base and bounds for multiple segments on here. Now, that actually has an upside. It's very quick to implement. Right? In other words, if we have a fault here, how do we calculate the physical address? Well, we take, in effect, the virtual address, jank it around with an offset, and dumb, we are given our physical address. Because, again, what's going on here, I can find, yes, here it is. Okay, these physical and virtual addresses are kind of assigned in lockstep when the segments are allocated. And so all we really need to do is, if we'll do a quick addition, subtraction, we're done. So it makes it very easy on this. So in one sense, that looks good, and it looks like we're actually going to be taking a step backwards here because, well, it's going to be harder to implement. Each segment of contiguous virtual memory maps to a corresponding block of contiguous physical memory. The quick translation comes with a downside that, again, this block of physical memory here, I'm sorry, virtual memory right here, maps to a corresponding contiguous block of physical memory. And we don't want that because, again, on a real system with pressure, we are going to, it's going to be very difficult to get 10 contiguous blocks of physical memory on this. So what we need to do is, on a real system here, we need to have the ability to map scattered physical pages into one contiguous virtual memory block. Instead of having a requirement that a block of virtual memory requires a block of contiguous physical memory, we want to now be able to have it so that, if you will, multiple areas of physical memory. So like, let's say if I am given, put on your opera glasses here, okay, a block of virtual memory here, okay, and let's say a block of physical memory, okay, I could have, let's say, this one mapped to this, I could have this one mapped to this, I could have this one mapped to, would be this. You kind of get the idea. In other words, and then this is used for other stuff. So, in other words, even though I'm using discontinuous frames in physical memory, they map to something that's contiguous in virtual memory on that. Okay. The downside, of course, is it's going to be slightly more complicated to implement, but again, that's the point of the memory manager. Questions on this so far? Okay, next realignment page allocation on this. Okay, so what's going on? What do we have here with dumbVM? Right now, and again, this was also the question right at the end of lecture on this, with dumbVM, everything is allocated essentially statically when the program launches. Right? In other words, when init is created, or whatever you call exec2, if you will, launch another program from disk here. So, in other words, what that means is we essentially, okay, if a program is, let's say, 100K in length, we immediately allocate 100K for the executable code. We immediately allocate however much for global. We immediately allocate a 72K hard-coded stack. It's upfront. That's not what we want. What we want to do is support dynamic allocation on this. So again, if you look at some of the old blogs for OS 161 for previous classes, it does not apply. It's a last year that's got changed. You guys need to support dynamic allocations. Essentially, allocate pages on demand. And what that allows you to do is it allows dynamic growth of the stack, also heap, and also sparse segments and data structures. Again, one of the first tests that Jeff is going to be throwing at you is he's going to allocate, if you will, declare, I think it's like a 16 megabyte array, and you're only going to have like 4 megabytes of memory, and you better be able to support it. And you can do that if you have on-demand allocation. So this, if you will, is another thing. So essentially, don't allocate your memory until you actually need it. Questions on this? Okay. Now a lot of this stuff, again, you're not going to have to worry about until you get to 3.2, but just kind of refer to it later on. Swapping, this is assignment 3. Essentially, if you will, if you run out of physical memory on this, what you need to do is possibly page it out to disk on this. So again, obviously WVM does not support that. The stuff that I'm talking about here in terms of user space, okay, like all this stuff is relevant to assignment 3.2. You're going to need to know it, but it's not relevant to what you need for assignment 3.1. What you're going to need to do in terms of assignment 3.1 is the stuff we're talking about in terms of the core map, RAM, steel map, and let's actually, question, I'm going to go on to the next batch of slides at this point. By the way, I'm going to try to see if I can't combine these two decks of slides together. Last year, they were split up into two different recitations. This year, it makes no sense because of the way things are timing out. We need to dive into core map essentially today on this. So, okay, here we go. Core map. All right. What do you need to do to pass assignment, if you will, 3.1? This is what's going on here. Number one is reconfigure for assignment 3. What that's going to do is it's going to be pulling out DumVM and the stuff that's in that, and you're going to need to start replacing it with your own code on this. You have to design a data structure, right? In the same way that you have, let's say, your process tables, and your file handles, now you're going to need to start thinking about what is this representation of physical memory, the core map. And you're going to have to, just like in the same way you need to initialize your page tables, initialize your file tables, you're going to need to initialize your physical page tables, aka core map. Okay. Two functions here, allocate pages and pre-cake pages. We looked at those a few minutes ago. Again, you can see examples of how it kind of doesn't work in DumVM. But essentially, you want these two functions here to take a look at the core map and in allocate pages needs to search the core map for a free page, and free cake pages says, you know what, I'm done with the page, so update the core map to, if you will, say, hey, this frame is now free. And the goal of this in terms of points for the class is pass tests KM1 through KM5. By the way, these tests are ones that you have to run through the kernel menu directly on this. So the tests for assignment 3.2 and 3.3 will once again be run from user land, but these are run directly at the kernel menu. Questions about the overview? Yes.
Is our system going to crash the moment we boot up for 3.1? Because
yes.
We don't have any of this.
As soon as you remove WVM, you can, well, yes, no. You can boot to your, oh, wait a minute. Yes, exactly. Yes.
I don't think you could boot to the kernel without having.
You won't even be able to boot into the kernel because
yeah.
We'll not have it. There's ways to make that pill go down a little bit smoother. You know, like we can. You're going to need to do like a lot of breakpointing. This is one thing, well, talk to the office staff too. But I would say too, there's going to be some arithmetic that involves in that. Do a lot of planning ahead of time. Probably one of the toughest parts about this assignment is you're not even going to be able to do like a lot of panic breakpointing because until it is at least minimally functional, your kernel won't boot. And again, speak to us. We have some shortcuts that will at least, you know, you don't have to have it completely functional. Okay, and we can go over some of the details about this is the absolute minimum just to get a booting kernel menu so you can start your debug process. But yes, that is a known issue. As soon as you pull out WVM, you can't boot. Other questions? Alrighty. So here we go here. Again, what this is, it is a map of the physical memory, aka a frame, aka a page frame, aka a physical page, what have you here. So what we're keeping track of is the state of physical pages. Again, address space keeps track of virtual pages on this. Now, problem number one here is initialization. Remember we said that what you need to do is initialize your data structure here. And another chicken and egg problem on this. Not only will you not be able to boot your kernel, when do we actually initialize this bugger on here? Well, there's a couple places. The reason we're talking about this here is a lot of old forum posts and whatnot used to talk about initializing it in the VM bootstrap function. To make a long story short, that won't work, right? I don't know if that's what the original design of the people at Harvard were, but it's not going to work. Because let's actually see what's going on here. The thing about, if you will, the initializing core map in VM Bootstrap is, take a look at the order of initialization in main.c here. Essentially put, let's actually, where are we? Yes, here we are. Come on. Okay. Let's take a look. All right. I haven't looked at this already here. This is in main.c. And this is the code that's run when OS-161 is initially booted up here. You're going to need to start paying attention to this code here because there's chicken and egg and dependency issues on this. Essentially, the first, if you will, thing that gets called is RAM bootstrap. And then VM bootstrap doesn't get called until all the way down here. And the reason that's a problem is that what's the core map for? It's essentially used to, if you will, keep track of physical memory on this. We need to be able to support things like kmalloc requests as the kernel is booting. And the problem is that we're going to get our first kmalloc request in proc bootstrap. Do we see a problem? Houston, we have a very big problem on this. Because we need to be able to support kmalloc in proc bootstrap. And how do we do that? With our core map. But if we don't set up our core map until down here, we ain't even going to boot here. So that's why I say that you're not going to be able to do your core map initialization in VM Bootstrap as counterintuitive as it is. You're going to essentially have to put it somewhere before proc bootstrap, either in RAM bootstrap or write your own function on that. But essentially, you have to initialize the core map, this is the takeaway here, before proc bootstrap hits. It is something that has to be done very early on. So let's go back to here. So again, the upshot here is we need to support kmalloc requests before we initialize the core map. allocate supports the request itself here. We can't. This is what's suggested on some old forum posts, is to use the dumb VM allocator and then switch over. It will no longer work with the new tests. Here's why. If you use, let's say, dumb VM to support the first few kmalloc requests during boot up, and then you switch over and you put your core map in, this area of stolen memory is never going to be reclaimed. You will leak memory permanently and you will flunk tests on this. So to make a long story short, this approach will not work. So what you instead need to do is initialize the core map before the first kmalloc call, which means essentially before proc bootstrap. So this again, how are we going to actually make this work here? So what we want here is before RAM bootstrap, we get to proc bootstrap, we need to install our core map above the kernel here, all right, so that it's already set to handle all kmalloc requests before we get to proc bootstrap. Questions so far? So essentially, takeaway number one is we need to initialize this bugger really early on. Now let's take a look at, if you will, some additional considerations here. What's the purpose of the core map? It's to hold the state of physical memory here. So in terms of software design considerations here, what type of data structure do you think we might want here? How about number one? Is access speed going to be important? Probably right, yeah, a lot, very. You're going to need to be able to, this is on a hot path, I need to get information about a physical page, what? Okay, how about another thing? Dynamic resizing. Are we going to ever change the size of our physical memory? Unless we're on a server and we do hot swap or something like that, probably not. Okay, so we know essentially that the number of entries in our core map is going to be fixed and that we need to access it quickly, which tells us what we might possibly want to do in terms of data structure.
Hash map?
I'm sorry?
Like a hash map or something?
That would definitely be very fast. How about keep it simple, even simpler?
An array.
Huh?
An array.
Yeah, just a simple array on this, okay? So just to declare, because the key thing, look, our size is never going to change here. So we can declare an array and get out of it. We already talked about when to initialize it. Unfortunately, very early on, talked to the staff about this, but essentially, chicken and egg issues. Okay, where to allocate it? Let's talk about this. Another chicken and egg issue here. How about declaring it on the stack with a kmalloc? What's our problem with that? We're trying to support kmalloc. The point of core map is so that we can have kmalloc. So we can't use kmalloc to set up the core map. So that's a non-starter. Well, can we have a global array? That would work very nicely, except for one small fly in the ointment here, which is that how big is our array? It depends upon the amount of physical memory. And how much physical memory are we going to have in our system? You tell me. That's in that sys161.conf file, and the test will be configuring with your kernel with various amounts of memory as you're going on. And indeed, this is true of a real operating system. When you buy Windows on a computer or in a box in a, let's say, a computer store, it doesn't say this version of Windows is suitable for 16 gigabytes and this one is suitable for 32 gigabytes. You don't buy, let's say, Mac OS X that said that this version will only run on 64 megabytes. You expect it to be able to use essentially however much memory you have. So the problem here is we can't declare a global array either. So essentially what we're going to have to do is manually create this data structure ourselves. It's a bit of a pain, but this is actually what you have to do. Question?
Could you set a minimum though?
I'm sorry?
Could you go with a minimum?
I'm not sure what you mean.
So like with your example, a lot of the time those systems will say like you need a minimum of this amount of memory for it to work. So couldn't you just go like that route?
You definitely could, and that will allow you to boot, but then how are you going to essentially, if you will support that additional array? So I think what you're proposing is kind of a bootstrap approach. Declare a minimum to get it started, and then once it gets started, maybe expand it. That actually is ingenious, okay? I frankly have not thought about that. Okay, I bet that probably would work. In other words, declare a minimum and then get it booting, and then you could at that point do a kmalloc.
Yeah.
Sweet. Okay.
The core map can be changed later.
Or create a Mac. I'm sorry?
The core map can be changed later, right?
It depends how you set up the core map. The other thing is you can create it manually on this. Okay. Either way, I will say, I promise, the arithmetic, it's conceptually fairly straightforward, but it's just mechanically intricate. It's like exec. Okay. It's conceptually straightforward. You import arguments and then you export them. Mechanically, you know what it is. It's a pain. Okay? It's kind of the same thing with core map on this. But yeah, that's actually cool. So yes.
The thing with that though is that if you make it initially, then you won't be able to actually go ahead and change that program one.
Well, probably not on this. I think what you're talking about is making just, you know, we're going to guess that this is the absolute minimum we need to boot the system and then enough to get kmalloc supported, and then, I don't know, that's, you know, I would have to think that through, but I mean, I think it's an intriguing approach on this. But you can also set it up manually.
Yeah, because like you don't necessarily need to create the core map all the way through right away, but you need enough to just get it going, and then you can finally initialize it later on.
Well, I will say you do have enough information to be able to calculate it manually. But, no, I'd say try it and let me know how it works.
Definitely.
Absolutely. Aside from that, cool, use the core map. Again, I talked about this earlier, essentially it's everyone. So you're going to have to take care of global synchronization issues. And I think that's all she wrote. Yep. And initialization. Mechanically intricate. Oh, yeah, it should be fully aligned. Okay, in terms of what actually goes into the data structures, remember it's going to be an array of thingamabobs. Essentially what you need to keep track of right now is a particular page frame, whether or not it's allocated, and the size of the allocation. Because remember, kmalloc could come in and say, you know what, give me 10 contiguous pages on this. And the core map is going to have to keep track of the number of pages in each particular request on this. Right now, essentially, this is all you need to keep track of in your core map. You're probably going to have to add more goo later on, but for the purposes of assignment 3.1, that's really all you need. Questions? That's assignment 3.1. Okay? So I would say start by, there you go. This is an example of what it is. Yeah. Not sure what those guys, that's from last year. Okay. So to recap, what do you need for core map here? What you are doing is you need to design a data structure that represents physical memory. You need to initialize the core map, and you need to write a couple functions to support kmalloc and k3 on this. Take a look at dumbVM for kind of how it's done right now. Again, that's not a good design going forward. Most of the stuff in dumbVM relates to assignment 3.2 and following. But for the stuff vis-a-vis assignment 3.1, what you want to do is take a look at, if you will, the functions that relate to 3.1, and what do you actually need to do to implement this stuff in terms of, like, when you do the allocation. It's going to have to be very early on in the boot process, at least for part of it. Okay. Think about the nature of the data structure. Probably it's going to be an array, possibly in combination with something else. In terms of where you actually want to put it, again, you can't simply do a kmalloc allocation or a straight up global request. So you're going to either have to possibly create it manually or maybe some hybrid. That's actually cool how that works out. And that should be about it. All right. Next people, questions? Have at it.